It's because sexual activity and sexual intimacy is designed to be an expression of a spiritual intimacy and a soulish intimacy that we begin by finding in experiencing and enjoying the love of God.
Second series of messages from Charles Price based on the book of Ephesians. This series teaches us how to be drawn into a closer relationship with Christ through the working of the Holy Spirit. Today's message is called Love and Sexual Behavior.
Well, let me read you from Ephesians chapter 5. If you've been here over recent weeks, you know we have been looking through this letter of Paul to the Ephesians. And here in chapter 5, he addresses some important relationships. He starts by warning against what he calls sexual immorality and impurity. And then he talks positively about marriage, husbands and wives. Then he talks about family, parents and children. Then he talks about living in the workplace, masters and servants. That extends into chapter 6. But in the middle of this, is verse 18, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Because when Paul talks about the responsibilities that we have to live the quality of life he has called us to live, he never separates those from the resources that we have that equip us to live that kind of life, which includes, in this passage, be filled with the Spirit. And we'll talk about that next week in particular, but that verse can be applied retrospectively back to what he's saying in the first part, as well as what he says in the second part of this chapter as well. But let me read you the first 14 verses where Paul says, be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children and live a life of love just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But among you, there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For it is light that makes everything visible. That is why it is said, "Wake up, O sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." That's as far as I'm going to read, but please keep your Bible open there. When Paul begins this section, he talks about love. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love just as Christ loved us and gave himself for us. And he stresses the fact that because you are loved by God, dearly loved children, because Christ loved us, and the demonstration of that is supremely in giving himself up for us, and as a result of this, live a life of love. That's what he says in these first two verses. But then he says, but living a life of love means that you say no to illicit sexual behavior. Because verse 3, among you there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or of greed. Now, why does he write these two verses back to back like that? The first two verses are wonderfully exalting verses about knowing the love of God and loving out of the love of God. And then the next verse, he suddenly plummets down to the fact, but don't you ever get involved in sexual immorality or sexual impurity. It's because sexual activity and sexual intimacy is designed to be an expression of a spiritual intimacy and a soulish intimacy that we begin by finding in experiencing and enjoying the love of God. You and I were created to live in intimate relationship first with God. And so he's affirming that when you find that satisfaction in God, that you are loved. And as a result of being loved, you're able to love others. Then the role of our sexuality finds its place and finds its function in the context of being fulfilled in our own hearts and spirits and souls by knowing that we are loved. G.K. Chesterton once wrote that every time a man knocks on the door of a brothel, he is looking for God. That's a very profound thing, because the need and the desire for intimacy that we have grows out of our need to know God in the first instance and be known by God and to be loved by God and to be loving. And in that context, and we'll talk in a moment about in human relationship as well, that the sex act is an outward expression of something deeper inside. But what he's saying is, if you don't know the love of God and you don't know what it is to be satisfied intimately in your spirit and soul, you'll be prey to all kinds of sexual immorality and impurity, which are the words that he uses here. And so what he's saying is, love means saying no to illicit sexual activity. Now, we live in a sex-saturated culture. We're all aware of that. The media bombards us. The internet gives us access to anything that you want. Contemporary morality celebrates all kinds of sexual activity. In fact, sex has become a recreational feature of our lives, but divorced from its real intent and real purpose and what it really says. Because sexual immorality is a symptom of something very deep within our own lives. This is the message in this passage. People who find themselves turning to pornography, as so many do, are trying to mask a pain within themselves, something that's gone wrong inside of themselves. And this is a way of soothing it temporarily. The context in which Paul is writing here is the city of Ephesus, which was built around the worship of the goddess Diana, who was a huntress and a god of hunting, but she was also the goddess of fertility. And there was very much sexual deviation associated with the temple of Diana in Ephesus, and temple prostitutes and virgin girls were brought there to the temple and offered sexually. And so Paul is writing right into a context where sexual immorality has been so normalized that people are unable to distinguish between right and wrong. And I don't think that for many centuries that our present Western world has been as close to the morality of the first century under Roman rule, renowned for its sexual liberties, as it is today. Some of you have been alive long enough to see incredible changes take place in our perception of the role of our sexuality. We talk about the sexual revolution, which took place in the 60s and the early 70s. It's usually dated back before that to Sigmund Freud's writing on psychoanalysis, where he proposed that human behavior was motivated by the unconscious drives of our libido, or our sexual energy, as he describes it. And when these drives were repressed and suppressed, they often found expression in various forms of neurosis, and it forms a key factor in Freud's psychoanalysis. And so people then began to look into this whole question of whether repressed sexuality and suppressed sexuality is something which should be avoided at all costs. And of course, repression is never a good thing. But then in the late 1940s and early 1950s, Alfred Kinsey published two surveys on modern sexual behavior in North America. And they were published at a time when public morality restricted the discussion of sexual issues. It was not the thing you did. And suddenly this book was available and people began to talk about some of the controversial issues that Kinsey raised in his book. And then came Masters and Johnson's work in 1966 on human sexual response. And it revealed the nature and scope of sexual practices amongst young Americans in particular. Around that time too, Playboy was first published. At its peak, Playboy was selling 7 million copies every month. And it was claimed that 1/4 of all college-age men were buying copies of Playboy. Now its circulation reduced dramatically, due no doubt to the cheaper and easier access to pornography on the internet. In the 60s also was the development of the birth control pill, which made it easier for people to engage in sexual practices without fearing pregnancy, and is widely regarded as a contributor to the sexual revolution. And then laws in Western nations, and I'm speaking of the Western nations because we're a Western country here, began to repeal laws which had governed sexual behavior in Canada. In 1969, a law was passed to decriminalize homosexuality, and the same law allowed abortion. And since then, much has developed to the extent that some of you have been alive long enough to see a complete reversal of what is right or wrong in sexual morality. What was wrong a generation or two ago is now applauded, and what was right a generation or two ago is now viewed as being restrictive and wrong. And Paul, writing to an environment in Ephesus, which is very similar to the environment we are creating in our own world, he is saying to them, but among you, in verse 3, that is you believers in Ephesus, amongst you, there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. I want to talk about two things from these verses this morning. I want to talk about sexual communication, first of all, because it is communication. And then I want to talk about verbal communication. Paul then talks about talking about these things and coarse joking and not even mentioning things that the disobedient do in secret. So we talk about what he says about verbal communication. First of all then, let's talk about sexual communication. And he's talking here about illicit heterosexual activity. And there are two kinds in particular, in general terms. There's fornication, which is premarital sexual relationships. And there is adultery, which is extramarital sexual relationships. Now, to understand these prohibitions regarding sexual activity, we need to remind ourselves of the general context in which Scripture speaks of sex. It tells us back in the beginning that God created them male and female. He created the sexes, the genders, and his intent was that a sexual relationship would be enjoyed within the context and bounds of marriage. And there are good reasons for that. We'll comment on in a moment. You see, in the record of God's creating, he says of every stage of creation, God saw what he had made and it was good. God saw it was good. 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 And then it says God saw all that he had made and it was very good. Then it says in Genesis 2, verse 8, there was one thing that was not good. In the goodness of what was very good, it was not good for man to be alone. This was before the fall. Because God created human beings as social beings and as sexual beings, and it's not good to be alone, to be isolated. We're made for social friendship. and we're made and designed that we should live in a sexual relationship, which is designed to be within marriage. Now, the fall destroyed everything. And like everything else, sexuality has fallen into trouble. And what holds potential for some of the highest joys can also bring some of the deepest hurts and pain and sadness. There are things that are sexually right and there are things that are sexually wrong. And sexual sin, Scripture says, is different to other sins because in 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 18, Paul says all other sins a man commits are outside his body. But he who sins sexually sins against his own body. He does damage to himself. Now, sexual sin is rooted in lust, not in love. And there's a huge difference between lust and love. Lust is not the same as sexual desire. We all have sexual desire, but lust is a self-centered seeking for self-satisfaction and is based on greed. Whereas love in a sexual relationship is other-centered, it's based on giving and it's desirous to give satisfaction to the spouse. Paul links sexual immorality to greed then, verse 3. Among you there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or any kind of impurity or of greed, because he says this is a selfishly motivated greed. Talks in verse 5 about the immoral, impure, or greedy person. Lust is based on greed, self-satisfaction. Now, sometimes we confuse lust with love. There is a story in the Old Testament in 2 Samuel chapter 13. Now, I'm just going to read this story to you because it is a good example of being driven by lust. It says there, 2 Samuel chapter 13, verse 1, in the course of time, Amnon, son of David, fell in love with Tamar, the beautiful sister of Absalom, son of David. Amnon became frustrated to the point of illness on account of his sister Tamar, for she was a virgin, and it seemed impossible for him to do anything to her. Now, Amnon had a friend named Jonadab, son of Shimeah, David's brother. Jonadab was a very shrewd man. He asked Amnon, "Why do you, the king's son, look so haggard morning after morning? Won't you tell me?" And Amnon said to him, "I'm in love with Tamar, my brother Absalom's sister." "Go to bed and pretend to be ill," Jonadab said, "and when your father comes to see you, say to him, 'I would like my sister Tamar to come and give me something to eat. Let her prepare the food in my sight so I may watch her and then eat it from her hand.'" So Amnon lay down and pretended to be ill. When the king came to see him, Amnon said to him, "I would like my sister Tamar to come and make some special bread in my sight so I may eat from her hand." David sent word to Tamar at the palace, "Go to the house of your brother Amnon and prepare some food for him." So Tamar went to the house of her brother Amnon, who was lying down. She took some dough, kneaded it, made the bread in his sight and baked it. Then she took the pan and served him the bread, but he refused to eat. "Send everyone out of here," Amnon said. So everyone left him. Then Amnon said to Tamar, "Bring the food here into my bedroom so I may eat from your hand." And Tamar took the bread she'd prepared and brought it to her brother Amnon in his bedroom. But when she took it to him to eat, he grabbed her and said, "Come to bed with me, my sister." "Don't, my brother," she said to him. "Don't force me. Such a thing should not be done in Israel. Don't do this wicked thing. What about me? Where would I get rid of my disgrace? And what about you? You would be like one of the wicked fools of Israel. Please speak to the king. He'll not keep me from being married to you." But he refused to listen to her. And since he was stronger than she was, he raped her. Now listen to this verse. "Then Amnon hated her with intense hatred. In fact, he hated her more than he had loved her. And Amnon said to her, "Get up and get out." And a few verses later in verse 20, it says, "Tamar lived in her brother Absalom's house, a desolate woman." Amnon kids himself. I love this girl who was a half-sister, actually. Full sister of Absalom, half-sister of Tamar. He didn't love her at all. And when he had abused her, he hated her, it says, with intense hatred. In fact, his hatred was more than he'd loved her. Lust centers on myself. But you say, well, okay, but surely you can love a person who you're not yet married to. Is not sex legitimate outside of marriage in those circumstances? But Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 7 why it is not. If you read that chapter, first part of that chapter, he talks about how sexual relationships work in a marriage. And he says in verse 4, the wife's body does not belong to her alone, but also to her husband. In the same way, the husband's body does not belong to him alone, but also to his wife. He says the context for a sexual relationship that is wholesome and healthy and that works in the way it's intended to work is that you no longer belong to yourselves, you belong to the other person. A wife belongs to her husband, husband belongs to his wife. That doesn't mean that you own each other, that's very different. But that you have surrendered yourselves to each other. And that is what a wedding day is about. A wedding day is a surrender of yourself to the other person, publicly affirmed. See, people who say wedding is just a ceremony and marriage is just a piece of paper don't understand marriage. If it's just a piece of paper, do without it. But that isn't what it is. It is the context in which these two people no longer belong to themselves. But prior to that, you do belong to yourself. Marriage is likened to the Christian life later in Ephesians chapter 5. In fact, not only is marriage likened to the Christian life, but the Christian life is likened to marriage. You know, which comes first? Both illustrate each other. And there are two things that the Christian life and marriage have in common. They are surrender and trust. To surrender is to give up your independence and to no longer live for yourself. But you're living now in harmony with your wife, your husband, your spouse. The two will be made one. And at the same time, that relationship is entered into in a context of trust. You surrender to each other because you trust each other. And if the trust becomes undermined, it is very difficult to keep the relationship as it should be. It takes a while to rebuild it. And only in the context of surrender and trust is there sexual fulfillment. Now, the sex act and sexual fulfillment are two different things. And here in 1 Corinthians 7, where he talks about that, he says that not only is it a responsibility to each other, but it is an expression of the fact that you're not two but one, you're surrendered. And in that context, you are safe, you're secure, and it doesn't take place until marriage. And discipline, the discipline of chastity as a single person, is a good and a healthy and a wholesome thing. I used to say to students at Cape and Ray when I was there for many years, and we had students from 18 up to late 20s and some older than that, but the bulk were in that age group. And I used to talk about this with the students, sometimes one-on-one, but sometimes we did seminars on marriage and this kind of thing. And I used to say to the students that the best preparation for marriage is learning to be content in yourself as a single person. Because when you come into marriage, you don't come in saying, oh, at last, somebody's going to meet my needs, and you flop all over them to meet your needs. That's not going to make for a good marriage. You come in disciplined and secure, able to give, not to demand, to one another. But if you've never learned that discipline of restraint, it'll bring difficulties with it into the marriage. And how many women find themselves with their husbands demanding sexual activity when they're not ready for it? Because they've never learned restraint, never learned to be disciplined and whole in themselves. So you come into the relationship to give to one another. And going back to the way Paul writes this here and talks about, know that you're loved, you're beloved of God, and Christ loved us, and live a life of love. And then he talks about sexuality, that we need to find security in ourselves by finding that intimacy with God, which meets the deepest need of our heart, without which we look for substitutes. One of the most common will be sexual activity. It's a substitute for the real thing. Now, sexual activity is right in its proper context. It's a beautiful thing in its proper context. But you're giving, not just getting, because your deep need is met. And women know that better than men. Men can function physically. Women need to know that there is a soulish connection and a spiritual connection if the physical connection is going to be satisfying. And tragically, many Christians are turning their back on the New Testament teaching about marriage and about sexual relationships, and there are all kinds of things being printed these days, saying maybe we as a church have had it wrong in the past, and encouraging that sexual relationships are okay. And there are many who engage in premarital sexual relationships who would claim to be Christian living under the Lordship of Christ. According to George Barna and the Barna research team, published this in 2007. Many of you know him as one of the best known of researchers of the last decade or more. He said in 2007 that divorce statistics amongst Christians are now 2% higher than among non-Christians. Not only that, he said his survey showed that evangelical Christians divorce more than mainline denomination Christians like Lutherans, Anglicans, Presbyterians, more than Catholic, many more than Mormons, and 4% more than professed atheists, evangelical Christians. And Barna makes this comment, while it may be alarming to discover that born-again Christians are more likely than others to experience a divorce, that pattern has been in place for quite some time. And Barna says, I'm not surprised what this is exposing. No wonder people mock the Christian church. No wonder we have absolutely no authority to speak to the world about sexual issues and marital issues. Now, I know there are reasons why sometimes for two people in marriage, staying together has all kinds of pain that is much greater than if they separate, because something is wrong within that relationship and somebody is not willing to put it right. I know that happens, but it also seems very evident that many of us as Christians have driven a truck through the teaching about divorce in the New Testament. And we've sold out to the easy divorcism of our day. And we think it's okay. Sometimes the idea of grace, the very beautiful teaching of the Bible about grace, has been so wrongly interpreted to mean you can do anything and God will understand. So there's sexual communication that Paul talks about here. And then he talks about verbal communication. And we need to just look at what he says about this. Because if sex is sacred and holy and fulfills God's purposes, he says, in effect, don't belittle it by the kind of talk that you might engage in that is coarse and out of place. Look at verse 4. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. And later in verse 12, he says, it is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. John Stott, his commentary, says about these statements, they all refer to a dirty mind expressing itself in dirty conversation. And by our conversation, we sow seeds, we sow thoughts, we create pictures in people's minds that lead to temptation. Does that mean we never talk about sexual issues? No, of course we do. But he tells us how. He says you talk about them with thanksgiving. That's verse 4. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. That is, that if you're going to talk about sexual issues, it's in a context in which you can be thankful. That is, you are acknowledging thanksgiving in Paul's writings is acknowledging dependence on God. It's putting it back to God. And there are many things we can talk about in that spirit of thanksgiving to God. And if we can't talk about them in that spirit of thanksgiving to God, don't talk about them at all, says Paul. It'll dirty your mind as it dirties your tongue, and it puts poison into your mind. We need to acknowledge God in our sex lives. We need to be thankful to God for a proper place for sexuality. And we thank God for sexuality, not for immorality. That's the context here. And Paul gets very serious with this because he says in verse 6, let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. This is the context. He's talking about sexual immorality and sexual talk that is coarse and obscene. He says, don't let anyone kid you, because there'll always be those who will kid you with empty words that this is okay. But says Paul, God's wrath will come on those who are disobedient in this area. There are those who try to persuade us that sexual ethics of the New Testament are out of date, that fornication, sex before marriage, adultery, sex extra to the marriage, was written in a day when people could become pregnant. You don't want that to happen, but now we can avoid that. Let no one deceive you with empty words, says Paul, because this provokes the wrath of God. And in verse 5, he says, of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man as an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Meaning that you can be sure of this, that anybody living this way will not have a place in the working of God in our world. You're a Christian, but you'll be on the sideline. You won't know the blessing of God and the working of God. I think that's what he means by inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God, his work in our world. But Paul doesn't leave it there. He brings hope, because in verse 8 of chapter 5, he says, for you were once darkness. You were once in this position, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of light consists of all goodness, righteousness, and truth, and find out what pleases the Lord. So he says, although you have known this, and across this building this morning, and people watching on television or listening on the radio, many of you have been caught in sexual sin. Maybe you're caught now in sexual sin. There is hope. But it's interesting, Paul talks about that hope being you are now light in the Lord. Live as children of the light. You've got to bring this into the light and expose it. We rarely deal with sexual issues alone, privately, locked up in some secret corner of our lives. We rarely deal with them that way. They have to come out into the light. And then living in the light, and out in the light, when these are then exposed, he says, you find as you begin to live in the light, the fruit of the light consists of goodness, righteousness, and truth instead of the fruitless deeds of darkness he talks about in verse 11 and the things shameful to mention he talks about in verse 12. We have to be honest, bringing these out in the light with God, and many of us need to talk to somebody and bring them out in the light with somebody else who can help us. And we can learn some kind of accountability to help us through some of these deep things. There are a lot of folks who are caught up in pornographic use and many pornographic addictions that you're probably not going to deal with alone. It needs bringing into the light. But there is hope. There is hope. And these things are only a symptom. These things in themselves are a symptom of something deep inside, that spiritual, soulish intimacy we were created to enjoy, because it's lacking. We're masking the pain of that by thinking sexual thrills will satisfy us. And you know that they don't. You know, the scripture speaks a lot about our minds being set on things that are right and true. In fact, the word repent, I've mentioned this several times, literally means to change the mind. And Paul says in Philippians 4 and verse 8, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. And some of us have got to start shutting the doors of things that we do feed our minds on. Some of us need some accountability as to what we do on the internet. Blocks at least, but better still, there are all kinds of programs where you can have accountability relationship with somebody who knows where you've been. It brings into the light. It helps you so that you can put your minds on things that are more constructive and positive. Romans 8, verse 5 says, those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds on what that nature desires. That's why they live that way. Their minds gravitate back to what that nature desires. But those who live according to the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. That's Romans 8, verse 5. And the next verse says, the mind of sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. You see, we can't just reject these things from our minds, say, I'm not going to think about these things. We've got to replace it with something positive and constructive. That's why it is so important that this book, the Word of God, occupies your minds. David asks an important question in Psalm 119. How can a young man keep his way pure? Good question. And he answers it. By guarding it according to your word. Then he says two verses later, your word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. Not in my head, hid in my heart. I'm replacing these deeds of darkness with things that belong to the light, and I'm guarding it according to your word. And Jesus illustrated that in his own temptations in the wilderness when the devil came and tempted him in three crucial areas, and his reply to each was, it is written, and he quoted the word of God, this is what is in my heart, this is what occupies me. It's not just the word of God in your head, it's in your heart. It's right in the center of your being. And let me say this, if you're a Christian, but this book stays closed from Sunday to Sunday, and maybe even stays closed on Sunday, and you don't spend time in the word of God, you are not going to live victoriously. You're not going to. Allow your mind to be conformed to the word of God, and therefore to the ways of God, to the mind of God and the heart of God, and to the power of God. And Paul says in Colossians, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And as you do so, it replaces so many things that an empty mind will gravitate to, a spiritually empty mind will gravitate to, that are wrong. Trying to get your mind off something doesn't work. Getting your mind onto something does. And along with the Spirit of God, who Paul is going to talk about in the next few verses, and living in the fullness of the Spirit of God, is turning your mind to the things of God. When I was a young Christian, I knew there were all kinds of temptations that I had real difficulties with. And I one day made a list, got a piece of paper, made a list of all the areas in which I was likely to fall. And when I got to the end of the piece of paper, I had to tear it up and get a bigger piece because I had a lot more than I'd realized. I made a long list of all the things that I knew I was vulnerable in. Then I tried to find a verse that addressed every one of these temptations. And to my surprise, I found a verse for everyone. I was surprised because I thought I'd invented some of those sins. I didn't know they were so common. I used to carry it around in the back of my Bible, and I would turn to those verses and I would quote them. I'd hold onto them sometimes in the face of temptation. Until one day I was at a youth conference and I was speaking at it. This is many years ago. I left my Bible out and somebody found it, and they didn't know whose it was, but they looked through it and found my list of sins and temptations. And so they passed it around. And so I've never kept it in my Bible since. But how does the young man keep his way pure? He guards it by the word of God. And Paul says in finishing in verse 14, he says, everything that is exposed by the light becomes visible, for it is light that makes everything visible. That's why I bring it out in the light. And then he says, quoting from a verse in the book of Isaiah, wake up, O sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. He says, wake up. Some of you, he is saying, as believers in Ephesus, in this amoral environment in which you live, have been sucked into it. Wake up. You're destroying yourself. And so are some of us. But there's always hope. When we come in humility and acknowledge, Lord, I messed up in this area. Where you need to start is to say, Lord, going back to verse 1, as dearly loved children, live a life of love just as Christ loved us. I need to know I'm loved. And I need to love out of that being loved. And that deep need to be known and to be loved for intimacy, which is a spiritual need in the first instance, enables me then to cope with these other needs of intimacy, but which become substitutes for the soul and the spirit. And I want to say, if some of you need help in this, and I have no doubt that many do, we want to be able to help you. And I hope you'll have the courage to get in touch so we can help you with this. Because it's not a harmless little pet, though you may think it is. It's a very dangerous enemy of your soul.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in again next week when Charles Price continues his series on Ephesians, Be Filled with the Spirit.
Christianity is not just a certain set of facts we believe to be true. It's an experience of spiritual life. Growing Up in Christ is a 10-part series by Charles Price. It will inspire us to grow spiritually as we enjoy the fullness of the Holy Spirit. This 10-part series, based on the book of Ephesians, is available on CD and DVD. To order this series, write to the address on your screen. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. Unlock your spiritual capacity with this inspiring series, Growing Up in Christ. It's an experience of spiritual life.
Love of God, revealed in wonder by the works of a maker's hand. Seas that roar with thunderous splendor, fields that whisper at his command. All the joys of life we cherish are God's gracious sign. We are children of his promise, heirs of mercy and grace divine. Unfailing love from heaven's throne that sought me out and brought me home. My song of praise shall ever be the Father's love for me. Servant King, sovereign power.